Hello and welcome back to the Electronic Intifada livestream for Monday, December 11th, a day of global strike for Palestine. I'm Nora Barrows-Friedman with my colleagues Asa Wynn-Stanley, John Elmer, Tamara Nassar, and Ali Abu Nima. We're taking this episode to mourn, to grieve, and to celebrate the life of our dear friend, Dr. Refaat Alareer. Thank you all for joining us. I know that people got to meet Refaat perhaps for the first time during our live streams over the past 2 months of this relentless slaughter in Gaza. And there are others who have known Refaat for decades and will be joined on the show today by many of his friends and students around the world who have had the exquisite joy of knowing and being known by Refaat. We'll also have some videos recorded by some of his former students in Gaza who sent them to us and who cannot join us live today because of the lack of internet connection as Israel continues to try and cut Gaza off from the world. For those who knew and loved Refaat and his work, we wanted to present today's episode as a virtual azza, a condolence visit, where people can come and express to Refaat's family and community how much he meant to them, and to carry on his work and love for his people and this world. And we'll be able to send this episode to his family so they can accept these condolences. I kept thinking over the last 4 days that Refaat would want us to be angry at his death, but wouldn't want us to despair. He wouldn't have wanted Israel to steal our time that way. He told us, he told you, Ali, on one of our live streams, that we haven't given in to barbarity, and that we won't let them make us give in to despair and defeatism. We refuse. And that is what the enemy feared in Refaat and what it fears in every Palestinian, in all of us, the most. Refaat epitomized dignity and courage and bravery, everything that the enemy who stole his life will never have the privilege of experiencing. I miss him. I miss joking with him. I miss seeing that glint in his eye and his smile. And I'm angry. I'm angry for his wife and his kids and for the thousands of students who won't get to sit in a classroom with him and for the papers and the essays and the poems that he won't write. And yet I know and we know that the seeds he planted are growing into a vast forest all around the world, that he is immortal. He is with us. He is inside each expo marker and each blackboard and each kite that will ever fly over Gaza in a liberated Palestine. Ali, I want to turn it over to you for your opening remarks.
Thanks, Nora. On our program last Thursday, I mentioned that we hadn't heard from Refaat and some of our other friends in Gaza for several days. I told you, as I reassured myself, that this was most likely due to the failing electricity and connectivity between Gaza and the world. We'd had these silences before, sometimes for days, and I felt sure that before long, Refaat's name would pop up in my notifications with his typical phrase, "We are fine," or one of his notorious jokes. Instead, moments after we ended the live stream, I received a message from a mutual friend, "Ali, Refaat is dead." Like everyone who heard these words, I refused to believe them, and part of me still doesn't. I'm still somehow waiting for a response to my last message. Refaat, any news? What we know is that on Wednesday, Refaat was at the home of his sister in the Al-Sidra neighborhood of Gaza City. At about 6 p.m., a missile was fired at the building, killing Refaat, his brother Salah, and Salah's son Muhammad, and Refaat's sister Asma and three of her children, Ala, Yahya, and Muhammad. The airstrike surgically targeted the apartment on the second floor and not the entire building, indicating the apartment was the target, according to the human rights group Euromed. Refaat was 44 years old. A close friend of Refaat told Euromed that days before he was murdered, Refaat had received an anonymous call from someone who identified himself as an Israeli officer and threatened Refaat that they knew precisely which school he was sheltering in and that advancing Israeli forces would soon reach his location. That call prompted Refaat to move to his sister's apartment, thinking it was less conspicuous than the overcrowded school. I'm certain, too, that Refaat left the school because he did not want to endanger other people by being there. Yesterday, I was able to reach Rifat's wife, Nuseiba, on the phone at a shelter in Gaza to convey our condolences to her and their children, Shayma, Omar, Ahmed, Lina, and Amal. I told her how much Rifat meant to us and asked if she had seen any of the many tributes to Rifat. Did she know that people around the world are raising Rifat's picture and reading and translating his words? We don't know anything, she said. We have no internet, no connection, just the telephone. She said Rifat used to travel long distances to try to find internet so he could connect with the world and continue his work. So part of the reason, as Nora said, that we pay tribute to Rifat today is so that his family will one day soon, in better days, be able to see for themselves how much Rifat meant to the world. Those of you who've watched Rifat's appearances on these live streams and have read his articles for the Electronic Intifada in the last 2 months know that he and his family had already been displaced several times after Israel bombed their home in late October. Despite having to care for his own family, Rifat never stopped helping others, carrying water and doing other tasks in the shelters. He never complained about discomfort, despite the appalling and dangerous conditions, the most appalling conditions humans can face. Anytime I asked him how he was, he would eventually text back, "We are fine." Over these last two horrifying months, Rifat comforted me much more than I could comfort him. And I know that's true for many of us. I treasure the memories of the time I spent with Rifat in person in Washington, Philadelphia, Chicago, and California when he came to the United States in 2014 with Yusuf El-Jamal and Rawan Yahi to speak about Gaza Writes Back, a collection of short stories by young writers edited by Rifat and published by Just World Books. One cold night in Chicago became a legend. The night Rifat tasted deep dish pizza at Giordano's in Hyde Park near the University of Chicago. That night is still etched in my mind, heart, and stomach, Rifat wrote to me on October 31st. Rifat spent his last few days walking the streets of his beloved Gaza city alongside his friend Asim al-Nabih, who has known Rifat since childhood. Asim, who works for the Gaza municipality, said Rifat tried to help anyone he could, directing those looking for a place to go towards neighborhoods where he thought they could find a little more safety. And while doing all this, Rifat continued to write, continued to support his students, and continued to do his life's work. Asim said of Rifat, he could have lived and worked anywhere in the world and lived the best life, but he refused. Indeed, after his studies in Britain and Malaysia, Rifat insisted on returning to Gaza and building a future there, not just for himself, but for his country. Rifat was the proud son of a laborer in Gaza City's Shuja'iyya district and a professor of English at IUG, the Islamic University of Gaza. He was a co-founder of We Are Not Numbers, a project launched in Gaza after Israel's 2014 attack, to mentor and support young writers in the besieged territory to tell their stories to the world. It is through We Are Not Numbers and Rifat's work that the Electronic Intifada has been introduced to many of its finest writers in and from Gaza, some of whom you will meet today. Like so many Palestinians, Rifat's earliest memories were marred by Israeli violence. In his chapter in the recent book, Light in Gaza, published by Haymarket Books, Rifat writes about how both his father and mother were nearly killed on separate occasions by Israeli bullets and shells. As a child, he himself was shot by Israeli soldiers with rubber-coated steel bullets, and on one occasion, an Israeli soldier threw a rock at him from the roof of a building, injuring him in the head. Even before this genocide, Rifat and Nuseiba had, between them, lost dozens of relatives to Israel's decades of savagery. In 2014, Israel bombed Nuseiba's sister's home, killing her sister and husband and several of her sister's children. This horrifying toll Refaat wrote in a May 2021 op-ed for the New York Times, made them a perfectly average Palestinian couple. Refaat's first piece for the Electronic Intifada in 2014 told the story of his martyred brother Muhammad, or Hamada, who is beloved by thousands of children in Gaza for his character Karkur, a mischievous chicken, on the TV program Tomorrow's Pioneers. Refaat's weapon was the pen and sometimes the expo marker. In 1997, as an undergraduate, he chose to major in English literature. He explains in Light in Gaza, "I wanted to do more with my English skills and my experience being born and raised under Israeli occupation. I remember when I first heard the question, how many more Palestinians should be massacred for the world to care about our lives? I thought naively that repeating the question would change people, but Israel kept killing us and Israel kept destroying our lives." But Refaat was never discouraged, only more determined to use language to change minds and change the world. He learned the power of stories to comfort and move people in the most visceral way during Operation Cast Lead, Israel's barbaric bombardment of Gaza in December 2008 and January 2009. Refaat writes, "I remember during the onslaught spending 23 days telling my little kids, Shayma, Omar, and Ahmed, many stories to distract them. Some were stories my mother told me as a child, or variations on her stories featuring my children as the heroes and saviors every now and then. Even though bombs and missiles could be heard in the background, my children were transfixed, listening to my stories like never before." Refaat adds, "During the 2008-2009 attacks on Gaza, the more bombs Israel detonated, the more stories I told. Telling stories was my way of resisting. It was all I could do. And it was then that I decided that if I lived, I would dedicate much of my life to telling the stories of Palestine, empowering Palestinian narratives, and nurturing younger voices." And that is how Refaat spent his life to the very last day inside and outside the classroom. I do not want even to dignify with a response the vicious character assassination against Refaat that Zionists have engaged in, both to incite his murder beforehand and to celebrate it in the most depraved way afterwards. I will say that those who incited against him have his blood on their hands. But I do want to affirm here that despite the savagery Israel inflicted on his own family and on his people since his earliest days, Refaat always taught that we should see the humanity in everyone, but first and foremost in those who are demonized, marginalized, and despised. As we will hear today, Refaat loved to teach Shakespeare, not merely in appreciation of Elizabethan verse, but as a tool for his students to understand the world they live in and challenge its orthodoxies. Refaat writes, "Perhaps the most emotional moment in my six-year teaching career in IUG's English department was when I asked my students which character they identified with more, Othello with his Arab origins or Shylock the Jew. Most students felt they were closer to Shylock and more sympathetic to him than Othello. Only then did I realize that I had managed to help my students grow and shatter the prejudices they had grown up with because of the occupation and the siege." Everyone who knows Refaat knows that he loved his students. On November the 2nd, just a few days after his house was bombed, Refaat wrote to me how sad he felt that the thousands of books he had collected over 30 years had been destroyed. "The books can be replaced, Refaat. You cannot," I responded in an effort to console him. He replied, "All those pieces you published for my students keep me going." And when Rifat's house, family's house in Shuja'iyah was destroyed by Israel in 2014, he walked through the rubble with his friend Asim. Asim remembers that Refaat picked up the burned and charred papers with the poems and stories written by his students as if he had found a valuable treasure. Refaat is now among at least 17,700 martyrs in Israel's genocide. His story is just one among millions, and no one knew that better than Refaat. One day before he was murdered by Israel, Refaat told Asim, "If God lets me survive this war, I want to devote the rest of my life to telling the stories of the people here." Refaat won't be able to do that, so the task falls to us. If I must die, let it bring hope. Let it be a tale. Refaat is now the fourth contributor to the Electronic Intifada known to have been murdered by Israel since October 7th. Before him were Hud al-Susi, Ra'ed Qaddura, and Muhammad Hammo. All three were Refaat's students or mentees. Refaat's murder is part of Israel's systematic extermination of the Palestinian intelligentsia in Gaza, including prominent doctors, researchers, and dozens of journalists. Just days before killing Refaat, Israel assassinated Dr. Sufyan Tayeh, a prominent scientist and the president of IUG. The poet and activist Ahmed Aburtema, a regular contributor to the Electronic Intifada, survived an Israeli assassination attempt in October that killed his 13-year-old son Abdullah and several other members of his family. In Light in Gaza, Refaat writes, "The wounds Israel inflicted in the hearts of Palestinians are not irreparable. We have no choice but to recover, stand up again, and continue the struggle. Submitting to the occupation is a betrayal of humanity and to all the struggles around the world." Refaat embodied everything Israel hates and seeks to destroy: knowledge, compassion, empathy, selflessness, and a determination to resist its savagery and tyranny and seek liberation no matter what the price. That is why Israel killed him, and that is why, through all of us here, Refaat and his mission will continue to live.
Thank you so much, Ali. And before we go to our first guest, we wanted to show this very short reading and animation someone did on Twitter of Refaat's poem, "If I Must Die," that we thought was beautiful. Let's go to that.
I must die, you must live, to tell my story, to sell my things, to buy a piece of cloth and some strings. Make it white with a long tail, so that a child somewhere in Gaza, while looking heaven in the eye, awaiting his dad who left in a blaze, and bid no one farewell, not even to his flesh, not even to himself. Seize the kite, my kite you made, flying up above, and thinks for a moment an angel is there, bringing back love. If I must die, let it bring hope, let it be a tale.
And since the news of Refaat's murder, people have been commemorating and grieving him around the world. And that poem of his has been translated now into at least 260 different languages. It's a way that people all over the world are keeping his words alive and universal and immortal. We wanted to show some of those translations. Again, more than 260. The thread around social media has just been going and going and going, and it is just beautiful and a testament to how poignant and relevant and yes, universal and immortal Refaat's words are and will continue to be. So we encourage you to go mostly on Twitter, I think, but I'm sure it's on other platforms as well, and just you know, look at these incredible translations. It's just kind of overwhelming for sure. We wanted to bring in our first guest. We're joined by Yusuf Al-Jamal. Yusuf is a Palestinian writer and close friend of Refaat, who is also his student. Yusuf, it's really good to have you. It's unbearable to be talking about Refaat in the past tense. Thanks for being with us today.
Thank you for making the memory of Refaat alive. I will never talk about Refaat in the past tense.
Yeah.
I think Refaat is immortal. I felt so sad when I knew that he's stuck under the rubble. But also, I thought maybe he will rise from under the rubble, just like the phoenix, the famous bird that lived in Arabia and that was taken by the Gaza municipality as its symbol, just rising from ashes. This is how we have known Refaat, very energetic, full of life, full of jokes. I have known him since 2007. This is the year he returned back to Gaza and started teaching after obtaining his master degree in comparative literature at UCL. And that was my first year in the English department. And, you know, Refaat was my teacher at the time, and he continues to be my guide forever. He taught me English literature and translation. I took two courses with him, and he was very mean with grades, but he was very tough. But if you earn a grade with Refaat, then it's well deserved. I learned things I never learned elsewhere in his class. We studied about, you know, politics, literature, language, philosophy, history, cinema. He was an encyclopedia in many different ways. Then our friendship continued, and I'm not an exception to this. There are many students he taught who later became his close friends. He would invite us, you know, outside the classroom. He would always challenge us and give us homeworks just to make us think critically. Refaat was universal in his classroom. He taught American, English, African, Irish literature, and that's why he was also universal in his passing. There are a lot of people remembering Refaat now when translating his poem. I enjoyed, you know, also helping him train young people in Gaza, like providing logistics and organizing workshops on poetry, creative writing, literature, feature writing. He encouraged me to write too. And I wrote my first article for the Electronic Intifada, I think in 2012, on the killing of my brother and why I have two brothers named Omar. And I remember how Refaat was so happy that when the article was published, he shared it on social media, and he was always like praising me and encouraging me to write more. Then he suggested that I turn this feature into a short story, which I did. And then he published this story in Gaza Writes Back. We traveled the United States in 2014, Rawan and Refaat and I, talking about Gaza Writes Back and the power of fiction. And Refaat always believed that fiction is universal and it's timeless. Like it will be read 100 years later, as if it's written now. That's why he also encouraged his students to write literature, and he believed in the power of literature. He himself was a poet, as you know. He published If I Must Die. He published this poem actually in 2011, and he only pinned his poem to his timeline in November. Maybe he felt like his killing is a high possibility because of Israel's genocide. He also wrote another poem titled I Am You. So this is, you know, Refaat was a humanist in many different ways. He even tried to speak to the psyche of his murderers, Israeli soldiers, telling them, I am you. And again, I feel so sad, but I also remember Refaat as the greatest, you know, owner of all senses of humor. especially like brutal and dark humor. Even people who do not know us would sometimes think that we have like an abusive relationship because of his jokes. I always enjoyed these jokes. Wherever he went to, he left a mark. There is a chair in our friend's house in Washington, D.C. called Refaat's chair. And remember Ali when we had the pizza and he was making fun of the deep dish pizza and comparing it to the New York pizza, and like the memories he leaves and creates stays forever. Refaat also took me in his own home for 3 weeks when I did not have a home in Malaysia. So he, not just like a teacher and a friend, but a great human being. You know, we traveled Malaysia, we traveled nice states together. He always thought about his students inside Gaza and outside Gaza too. He sent me a number of articles written by his students, and he was also so happy when he saw them being published. So his students were, you know, the center of his life, and that's why, you know, everyone is sad and remembering Refaat and telling their, you know, beautiful memories with Refaat. I remember when we were in the United States, we spoke at different multiple places. And Refaat also managed to leave a very positive impact on people he met. And we've seen this actually in Philadelphia. Recently, there was a group of people who organized a vigil in memory of Refaat, who met him in 2014. So people still remember him up until now. It's been 10 years. 9 years since we visited Philadelphia together. He loved Gaza. He always, you know, told people that he's a son of Shuja'iyah, his hometown in Gaza. And I remember we walked over the Brooklyn Bridge, Jihad, Refaat, and I. And Refaat wrote the name of his town on the bridge, Shuja'iyah, and he took a picture. He was always proud of his town, telling people everywhere that Shuja'iyah, as if Shuja'iyah is like New York, known by everyone, and he wanted Shuja'iyah to be known by everyone. I'm very saddened, you know, that his life was cut short, but I am sure that Refaat will continue to live in the hearts of thousands of people, hundreds of his students, but also millions of people around the world who are translating his poem today. Because Refaat believed in the power of literature and writing, and he knew very well that his writings will live, you know, for a long time. And we've seen this, you know, 260 languages is a huge number. Maybe there is no other poem that was translated into 260 languages. And this is a message to all of us that we should continue writing and defending our cause as Refaat wanted. Refaat is the storyteller of Gaza, the father of storytelling in Gaza. And Refaat is also an idea. He's immortal and ideas do not die. He will always be there. We will see him. We feel him watching over us and guiding us every day in our life.
Yusuf El-Jamal, thank you so much. I wanted to bring on two of our other friends. First, I did want to say that the animation and voiceover of that poem that we just showed right before you came on was by someone named Maya, and her handle on Twitter is Maya Amer 2, and the song was sung by Nai Barghouti, and thank you so much to David Alvarez for giving us that information. That's really valuable. Thank you, Maya, for making that. So I wanted to bring on two more guests. Jihad Abu Salem, Palestinian writer and former student of Refaat, and also Shaima Ziyara, a Palestinian from Gaza, also a friend and former student. Shaima and Jihad, thank you so much for being here today. And you're both muted. So Shaima, let's start with you. Talk about your friendship with Refaat and how you came to be his student.
Thank you, Nora. I first met Refaat back in 2008, so that's over 15 years ago. I was only 14 years old back then, and he was my teacher in a youth program. At that time, I was a young, malleable mind, and it was an honor to have been his student and to get the privilege to have my whole worldview shaped by him. He introduced us to Malcolm X. He taught us about the Black Liberation Movement and helped us draw comparisons with the Palestinian struggle for liberation. He taught us about Edward Said's Orientalism. He encouraged us to think critically and to thoughtfully engage with literary characters we didn't necessarily agree with. He taught us to see humanity in everyone. Refaat is the reason I am who I am today. He didn't treat us like we were children. He never made us feel like he knows better than us. He treated us like great, capable minds, even when we were just, you know, foolish teenagers. In class, he liked to inject his lessons with humor. He would tell great jokes, but also a lot of lame ones too. He liked to tease his students. It was almost like a bonding exercise for him. He loved telling us about his mischievous shenanigans as a young kid and as a university student. And even at that time, he would tell us about the pranks he would pull on his friends as an adult. He never lost his sense of humor, even in the darkest of times that we're seeing right now. Refaat grew and we grew under his wings. When I went to university, he was also my professor, and I looked forward to every single class of his. We were discussing Shakespeare, performing soliloquies, writing poetry. We looked up to him like a big brother, like a friend that you know will always be there for you and will give you the best advice whenever you go for him for advice. In early November, when my brother Ahmad was severely injured in an Israeli bombing, Refaat was texting me almost every day whenever he gets a connection, and he would ask about him. My brother and I, by the way, share the names of Refaat's eldest children, Shaima and Ahmad. When my brother succumbed to his wounds, Refaat was devastated. He was the dynamite behind the freelance work of the youth in Gaza, Refaat said. And even in the darkest of times, when he was worried for his safety and for his family's safety, Refaat still made the time to check on me and my loved ones. In one of his interviews with Electronic Intifada on a live stream, he was talking about how bleak and dark the situation is. And that's when he broke down crying. Seeing that really broke my heart. This Refaat was always smiling, always quick with the witty, snarky remarks. He was overcome with grief. But by the end of that sentence, you could hear him regain his strength. And his voice getting stronger and becoming even more determined. Because that was Refaat. That's who he was. Like a phoenix, he would always rise up from the ashes. And today he still rises up through his legacy, through his words, his poems, his stories, and the minds that he has shaped. Just like in the poem of the Iraqi poet Ahmad Matar, Refaat is like a wheat stalk. Even when that wheat stalk is falling to the ground, he is only falling to plant more seeds. We are those seeds, and we promise to stand tall and strong and carry his legacy forward. And as Susan Abu Hawa said, Refaat did not die, he multiplied.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Shaima. Shehad, talk about your friendship with Refaat, please.
Thank you for having us. I met Refaat in 2004. I was 16 or 17 years old then. I was in the 10th grade, and I was chosen by my school in Deir al-Balah to attend a one-year English language program that was organized at Amedeast, which is an American educational nonprofit that had an office in Gaza City. And for a year, I commuted with a number of Palestinian students from Deir al-Balah, from Khan Yunis, from Rafah, from the north, from Gaza City, to Rimal, to Amedeist's office, to attend this one-year program. And I remember this day, walking into the classroom, there was this young teacher with his light beard, with his expo marker, welcoming us into the classroom. He had a gentle smile, a very polite and loving and caring demeanor. For me personally, as someone who has been going to public school for a few years, that was a change of scenery and a change of culture. And from day one, my colleagues and I realized how fortunate we were and how fortunate we are about to become, recognizing the impact Refaat will have on us. We did not fully comprehend what kind of role Refaat will play in our lives. I wasn't sure about him. He did care about his students, and at the same time, he roasted them, sometimes with his mean jokes and with his dark humor. He also wasn't sure about me, but we became friends, and one day he honored me by allowing me to add him on MSN Messenger, and it was a big deal for me. I thought I was the coolest kid in that program, to be able to chat, you know, to have like an instant messages with Refaat on a daily basis. We learned so much from him. When I wrote on Twitter the other day about how Refaat used the English language as a tool for liberation and defiance, and as a way to challenge Israel's siege on Gaza, that wasn't an exaggeration. You have to consider Gaza in 2004, 2005. This is the time when I met Refaat and I got to know him. Isolation wasn't just an abstract thing. It was an actual feeling that then would become worse and worse with the imposition of the blockade in 2007. So to have someone like Refaat who would tell you about the giants of literature, but also who would teach you about Malcolm X and Martin Luther King and the difference between them, and introduce you to the civil rights movement and to Desmond Tutu, and talk to you about issues and matters that were happening and things that were important beyond the confines of Gaza's blockade. For us, that was a big deal. And he blew our minds many, many times with the kind of knowledge he would impart on us as his students. And Refaat saw, and I talked about this, and I would keep repeating it. He saw in English as a language and as something that you embrace as part of your daily life. He saw it as a tool of empowerment, especially for young Palestinian students who come from impoverished backgrounds in the Gaza Strip. He, you know, when people learn and speak English in many parts of the Arab world, they do so as a way of detaching themselves from the larger society. It's part of, you know, a conscious or subconscious effort to become, you know, westernized in your own country, in your own society, to detach yourself from the people around you, to embrace Western brands, to connect to Western popular culture. It has a classist dimension, this practice. But for Refaat, it was the opposite. He taught English and encouraged people to learn it so that they can break free from the constraints that Israel has imposed on us as victims of its blockade and occupation and de-development and impoverishment. English becomes a tool to connect with other struggles, to learn about them, to understand the heroes and the giants and the ideas of these struggles and of these cases for liberation that are taking place around the world. So Refaat was free. He was free despite that he lived under occupation and despite all the pain that Israel has inflicted on him and his family. And Refaat freed us. We weren't, you know, we were young teenagers and you know, like people who are in their college age. Some followed Refaat's path. Others, you know, sometimes weren't sure what to do with the knowledge that he gave them. But I can tell you, Refaat freed all of us. He freed all of us, and he gave us a way to connect with the outside world, to learn more about ourselves, and to understand our experience better. Because when you grow up in Gaza under blockade, you grow better. You grow, you know, sometimes it could take you to very dark places in terms of questioning, why is this all pain inflicted on us? Is there something wrong with us? So Refaat comes and he tells you about the black struggle in America. He tells you about South Africa. He tells you about this issue and or that issue. And you begin to understand that, no, this is about injustice. And this is about, again, the universal connections that Yusuf talks about and Shaima also referred to. So, you know, there's so much to say about Refaat Alareer, and there will be plenty of time to honor his memory. And I think, you know, Refaat, again, like Yusuf said, he's not someone who we should talk about in the past tense. Refaat, however, entrusted me with a huge burden when I reached out to him to contribute to Light in Gaza, Writings Born of Fire, the book that you can see behind Ali. He told me, and I would like to quote him if I may. He told me, you know, that he's really tired of how unheard Palestinians are. So he wrote, "When I was approached to write for this book, the promise was that it will affect change and that policies, especially in the United States, will be improved. But honestly, will they? Does a single Palestinian life matter? Does it?" And then he wrote, "It shall pass, I keep hoping. It shall pass, I keep saying. Sometimes I mean it, sometimes I don't. And as Gaza keeps gasping for life, we struggle for it to pass. We have no choice but to fight back and to tell her stories for Palestine." But I would like to end with this. Telling the story is a burden on the victim and a burden on the oppressed. But us telling our stories, as Refaat taught us, isn't enough. There has to be people on the other side of the storytelling who listen and who take action. So listen to Refaat, heed his words, let it be a tale, and let it be a big fight for our liberation. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Jihad. Thank you so much. That was beautiful. Before we go to two more friends of Refaat, we wanted to talk about Refaat as first and foremost an educator. He loved the classroom, and we have a clip of him doing what he loved to do the most, teaching in a classroom in Gaza. The following clip is a part of a series of lectures that Refaat had posted on his YouTube channel. Let's go to that.
Personally, every time I teach a course, any course actually, I have one major goal in mind. I claim that I want to change my students' lives, hopefully to the better. Because I do believe, and this is, for many people, this is literature. What is literature going to change about me, or in me, or for me, or around me? It doesn't put probably food on table. It doesn't, I don't know, make me rich. Although it does most of the time if you are a successful writer, especially if you are a novelist. So I say the first thing in my course is that poetry is about making us better human beings. Poetry is about improving the way we look at things, the way we deal with others, the way we deal with life, with difficulties, the way we deal with ourselves, the way we treat ourselves, the way we think about things. And probably I usually mention this, how poetry is self-expression. And you said this already before, how poetry is self-expression. There's something you feel, that the urge to get it out. Whether you want to communicate or not, whether you want people to react to your self-expression or not, poetry, literature is an act, a very significant act of self-expression. I don't want to exaggerate, but could be as important as the need to eat sometimes.
I'm so grateful that we still have his voice. We are now joined by Noor Nemer, a Palestinian translator, a student of Refaat, and Ahmed Nahad, also a student of Refaat. Ahmed and Noor, thank you so much for being here. Ahmed, yeah, please go ahead.
hi, everyone. Thank you. I guess nothing, as Jihad said, nothing is enough to say about Dr. Refaat. Our friend Dr. Sara Ali says, everyone who talks about Refaat cannot but in a way talk about himself. And yes, Refaat shaped us all and made us the people we are now. One thing I didn't know, I always ask myself where Dr. Refaat brings and where he gets all this energy and strength to talk and write all the time about Palestine, about Gaza. I have spent most of my days with him as a friend and colleague, but actually as his mentee all the time. And I shared the details of his life, of his meals, of his jokes, of watching football together, or I don't know, bullying each other. And the more you get to know him, the more you respect this man. But still, one question I've never been able to answer is, how does Dr. Refaat find all this energy and hope to talk, to write, to put in so much effort and make such an impact? What I want to say to Omar, to Ahmed Yassin, to Shema, to Sara, to Amal, to Lina, to Umar, is that they should know they have thousands and thousands of friends and siblings in Gaza and around the world. I know nothing can replace Refaat, a giant who can do and excel in 20 tasks at the same time, better than 20 people and more can do one task. I keep saying this. I guess this is one thing that can, I don't know, sum up Dr. Refaat. One of the first memories I have of him, because I knew him since I was like 12. But one thing one memory I always have is attending a seminar for his friend Dr. Mahmoud Harthani in Gaza, and he was there to report the seminar. And I was sitting and he was in front of me, and I could see his MacBook. I could see him and everything he did. And I couldn't but see how, in the same time, he's listening to what Dr. Mahmoud's saying, being active and like participating in the discussions, and at the same time reporting what's happening in the seminar, and then at the same time tweeting on his multiple Twitter accounts, and the same time following the news and checking and editing texts and texting other people, and I don't know, making sure that everybody has a seat and making sure that everybody has their bottle of juice, and at the same time, again, being attentive and like making important points about what's going on. So I know nothing and no one can ever replace him, or even all of us together. But I want his sons and daughters and wife, and I want them all to know that we are here to try with whatever energy and life we have to continue his journey, his project, in every possible way. And I want to say to us, to his friends, mentees, and students, that we have a lot to do. Dr. Refaat left us until his last moment with many ideas, projects, texts, stories, films, and poems to complete. We owe it to him and to his Palestine that he loves, to continue his path. I have nothing to say but to testify that Dr. Refaat is one of those who suffered in many ways. The more you know him, the more you know Dr. Refaat and his life and the details of everything that he went through, the more you know how much he suffered and how much he had in his plate to do family-wise, community-wise, university-wise, everywhere. And he reached stages of despair and worry, just like many of us, many times. But I'm always amazed at how he could always come back stronger each time, with more productivity, with more texts, with more poetry, with more helping other people and reaching different platforms to talk and write about Palestine. And I know the path is full of these contradictions between hopelessness and hope. And I know he went through those contradictions all the time. But as he taught us, as he still teaches us, that we have nothing else, we have no other way but to continue to talk about Palestine, to write about Palestine, about Gaza, in every possible way, and just like him, unapologetically, and as strongly as possible. I saw Abu Omar put his whole heart into every story and article he wrote or edited with his mentees. He gave everything he had to his students, to his mentees. I had the privilege to work beside him. I had the privilege at the first place to be coached and taught by him. And then I had the privilege, thanks to him, to be his co-mentor and to be beside him. And I always thought I did a good job being a mentor, taking care of students and helping them in every way possible. I always thought I cared, but then I look just next to me to him and the way he talks to students and mentees, and then the conversations we'd have afterwards in his car, because he'd never leave me walk back to my office alone, even though my office is like very close, but he'd always like take me with his car, and like we'd talk about the day and about the students, and he'd still shout and be angry or be enthusiastic, or like he'd always talk about students and their works and like how amazed he is with the brilliance of them, or how disappointed he is that they lost this chance or this opportunity. And he'd always be like, I know this person or this mentee has a lot of potential, and I wish they could live up to this potential and do everything they can. He cared. And I remember always like having this argument with him, asking him, begging him to not care that much, because like even me as a student and many of us, we sometimes, or most of the time, we were afraid a little bit of him, because like we know we'd make a double space or deal of space before the comma, or we'd forget something important, or we would, for example, not know about Malcolm X or about any important activist. And he would like be really angry, not because he's angry, but more because he cared, more because he wanted us to be the best versions of ourselves. And as everybody said, as you had said, and like everybody, whenever we talk about Dr. Refaat, he always believed in us more than we believed in ourselves. And he always saw in us the potential we had. Sometimes he implanted this potential. He poured all his heart into making us better people in a way or another. And this thing he said in the clip you just shared about him having his aim as a teacher to change his students' lives, I don't remember a class he gave to me or I gave with him for the past 6 years without him starting with this. It was his true aim, and I saw with my own eyes, in myself as an example, and in hundreds of other people I saw myself, and thousands of others I learned about, how he actually changed our lives for the better. Not only as people, not only the way we think, but also he changed us in tangible ways. Lots of us had their first jobs or their first important jobs thanks to him, because he always recommended us to people. He always helped us get those jobs, and then he always helped us do them the best ways we can. again, as I said, he gave us all his heart, and I know that we owe it to him to carry this heart, to carry all this that he taught us, that he still teaches us, to continue his path, to continue writing, talking, resisting the occupation, and with I know, again, we have lots and lots to do, and I know we are all determined to continue this path, to continue all the unfinished projects, all the unfinished texts and ideas. that he gave us with all the energy and all the life we have, all the energy and all the life he gives us. Forever, the son of Shija'iyya, Dr. Refaat, Rafiq Alareer, in our hearts, voices, words, and resistance towards a free Palestine. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ahmed. Thank you. Noor Nemer.
Hi, everyone. Thank you all for sharing your thoughts and memories of Dr. Refaat. And thank you, Ali and Noora, and everybody for arranging this beautiful, meaningful live stream. I had the privilege of being Dr. Refaat's student in 5 courses, one of which is a literary translation course. He taught me literary translation in the most beautiful way I can ask for. And he believed in me. He praised the first poem I've ever translated and encouraged me to translate more and more. And now I am a translator thanks to him. Dr. Refaat has always put our interests first. I remember working on a research paper last summer with my friends Alia and Dunya, and we used to frequently go to his office and ask him plenty of questions. And despite his busy schedule, he would pause his work to listen to our questions, and he even rewarded us with bonus marks for doing so. And I guess we all know how rare and precious his bonus marks are. And in that same summer, my friends and I were planning to create a fan page to gather all the memes and the stickers we made or he made on him, on Shakespeare, on us, but we never did that page. I think when this war ends, we will create it as a small tribute to the joy and laughter he brought into our lives. Now, many students speak of how he pushed us to grow and to step out of our comfort zones. But what astonished me was his gentleness in doing so. I mean, I remember in my early college days, I was shy and sensitive. So when I get distracted in the class, he would seamlessly incorporate my name into examples to bring me back into focus and to keep me interacting. It was a subtle yet impactful way of encouraging me to engage in the lecture. Dr. Refaat has always felt a responsibility for every person he knew. During the war, he posted in our poetry course group to check on us. And he told us that he feels embarrassed for not knowing how to help us, while he himself was facing the same hard situation. And he also offered phone balance to anyone in need. As most of Dr. Refaat's students, I have many, many memories with him, but the one I will always remember him through is not the most significant one, but the latest one. Just 1 week before his martyrdom, I sent him my translation of his poem named Drenched to ask him if the translation is good enough to be shared. He read it and he told me it's excellent. And I was so happy because Dr. Refaat is the kind of person who always encourages you, yes, but he doesn't praise your work that easily. And he told me to post it on Twitter so he can repost it. And it was the first time Dr. Refaat shares on his personal account something I translated. And because I've always looked up to him, it really meant so much to me. And finally, I want to say that meeting Dr. Refaat was a turning point in my life. But his assassination, as painful as it is, marks an even greater turning point. He was a blessing I'll forever cherish, and I believe his legacy will continue to inspire us all, always and forever. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Noor. That was beautiful. We're going to bring on some more friends, colleagues, and students of Refaat's in just a minute. But some students were not able to join because, as I mentioned at the beginning, the unreliable connection in Gaza. Here's a clip that was sent to us by Iman El-Hajj Ali. She's a journalist and translator based in Gaza.
Israel has killed Dr. Refaat Alareer, but he's still alive within us. Hi everyone, this is Iman Al-Hajali, a Gazan-based journalist, translator and writer. Dr. Refaat was my professor at the Islamic University of Gaza. Yet he was more than that. He was like a father for everyone he dealt with. He was like a father for everyone he taught. I still remember our days at the university when he taught us many courses. Indeed, these courses are one of the most gorgeous courses that affected and shaped my personality. One of these courses is the world literature. I still remember how much he loved literature and how was that like a part of his personality. And that's greatly reflected upon us due to the great amount of information that he gave us. Indeed, I loved literature due to the way he explained it for us. Now, the English department has a great loss. Not only the English department, but all of Gaza, all of Palestine lost a great literature man. And we will never ever find such a great person like him. He taught me poetry, and now I'm writing great poems because of him. And I wish that he's still alive to show him these poems. He taught us Shakespeare, and I still remember how much he loved that great playwright. To the extent that whenever we were seeing him, we were talking between each other that Shakespeare has come. I still remember one of his lectures when he acted in front of us one of Shakespeare's Hamlet soliloquies, and he told us that this part is one of his favorite parts about how great the creation of the human is. And I want to say this for you, that how great you were is. I'm speechless indeed. Well, I want to say that what a piece of work Dr. Refaat Alareer is. How noble in reason, how infinite in faculty, in form, in moving, how express and admirable, in action, how like an angel. I still remember your sessions when you coached me about creative writing and how you were telling us all the time to fight with our pens, to use our words, even if they are the smallest thing that we can do to defend the Palestinian cause, to reveal the harsh reality about the cruel actions that are taken against us because of Israel. And you are now killed because you were not fearful, because you are not fearful of defending the Palestinian cause. You were not fearful of revealing the barbaric actions committed by Israel against us. But you are not killed. You are still alive within us. And we will take your footsteps to defend the Palestinian cause. As you told us in your poem, if I must die, you must live to tell my story. And I promise you, we will live to tell your story and we will write more and more. Israel now tries to kill the intellectuals and educated people like Dr. Refaat Alareer. They try to rip the tree of knowledge from its foundations, but they will not let us down. We will resist. We will write more and more. We will write volumes. We will write books to defend the Palestinian cause and to reveal the harsh reality that we are suffering from because of the cruel so-called Israel and its brutal actions against us. Thank you.
That's beautiful from Iman. Thank you so much, Iman. We're now joined by Malik Zakout, writer and translator, and also Khaled El-Hissi, journalist from Jabalia in the Gaza Strip. Malik, let's start with you.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes, we can. Thank you.
All right, thank you for having me. But before I go, just a quick comment on what Ahmed said about how he thought he did well. with the mentees, and then he looked at Dr. Rifat, and then he no longer felt he did well compared to Dr. Rifat. Ahmed, I know this will make you feel good. Students used to call you the other Rifat. Literally, they used to call you the other Rifat. And I know this because I was the project coordinator at which Dr. Rifat and Ahmed were mentors. Thanks to Dr. Rifat, he believed in me when I myself did not believe in myself. He called me one day and he was like, Malak, there is this opportunity. Ahmed, I'm so sorry. I just want you to be happy. He was like, Malak, there is this opportunity. And I think you're a perfect fit. And I was like, what was it? And he said, it's a project or coordination position. I was like, no way I'm going. And he was like, yes way you're going. And I was like, I'm not going to be accepted. And he was like, no, you're going to go to the interview. And I think it's not your call. Just do what you have to do. And then the next day I was accepted. I got my acceptance message. So yeah, without going longer,
I comment?
Had the honor to, of course.
I took one course with Mr. Ahmed. We were calling him the young Rifat. We were always calling him the young Rifat because he always used to be like Dr. Rifat. So yeah, Malik is right.
Yes. Okay, so I'm going to have the honor of reading I Am You by Dr. Refaat Alareer. I hope my recitation does it justice. Two steps. One, two. Look in the mirror. The horror, the horror. The butt of your M16 on my cheekbone, the yellow patch it left, the bullet-shaped scar expanding like a swastika, snaking across my face, the heartache flowing out of my eyes, dripping out of my nostrils, piercing my ears, flooding the place, like it did to you 70 years ago or so. I am just you. I'm your past haunting your present and your future. I strive like you did. I fight like you did. I resist like you resisted, and for a moment I take your tenacity as a model. Were you not holding the barrel of the gun between my bleeding eyes? One, two. The very same gun, the very same bullet that had killed your mom and killed your dad is being used against me by you. Mark this bullet and mark in your gun. If you sniff it, it has your and my blood. It has my present and your past. It has my present. It has your future. That's why we are twins. Same life track, same weapon, same suffering, same facial expressions drawn on the face of the killer, same everything, except that in your case, the victim has evolved backward into a victimizer. I tell you, I am you. Except that I'm not the you of now. I do not hate you. I want to help you stop hating and killing me, I tell you. The noise of your machine gun renders you deaf. The smell of the powder beats that of my blood. The sparks disfigure my facial expressions. Would you stop shooting for a moment, would you? All you have to do is close your eyes. Seeing these days blinds our hearts. Close your eyes. Tightly, so that you can see in your mind's eye. Then look into the mirror. One, two. I am you. I'm your past. And killing me, you kill you. Thank you.
Oh, Malak. That was extraordinary. Thank you so much. Khaled, what can you say?
I have a lot of things to say. As Ahmed said, no one can sum up Dr. Rifat. No one can describe the feeling he lived or being, what is the feeling of being a student with Dr. Rifat. But I'm very proud to be one of Dr. Rifat's students. I was and still a student. Dr. Rifat taught me. He taught me a lot of things. In classes, he did not only teach me poetry, drama, or Shakespeare courses, but he also taught me academic writing, creative writing, grammar, translation, although he wasn't the doctor for me for these things. In his classes, he also taught me history, culture, geography. Sometimes he taught me how to draw, even if my drawing was bad. He made me love Tamim al-Barghouti poetry. And maybe most importantly, he made me love and know how to create memes. I never saw a doctor uses memes as a method of teaching. He loved memes. He loved to meme everything. He made us love them too. Sometimes we were memeing him, and he would love that also. I think all of his students know that. We also used his photos as stickers on WhatsApp, and he never said anything about that, but he was also happy. He always encouraged us, encouraged me, encouraged other students to be creative, think outside the box, to get out of our comfort zone. As Noor said, he would tell us to come to the class without researching about the next poem. This was in the poetry course. I still remember this vividly. We would read the poem and discover it in the class. So he wanted us to be creative. He didn't want us to prepare and like to search about everything, then like come like and say everything like, you know. No, he wanted us to think, to be creative. I think that is his goal. He knew it was difficult for him to do so. And he would be mad at us sometimes. He would be mad at us very, very many times, because it was not easy for us to understand the whole poem without any previous researching. But at the end, when someone answers, or someone's like, know the answer of this question, he was like, he would be very, very happy. And he never gave up shaping our creativity. And to those who were creative, those students who were like thinking outside the box, he would reward them with a bonus mark. And only Dr. Refaat's students know how much it is hard to get a bonus mark from him. I would never forget his facial expressions when he gave me one. This is one of my best memories. Like, he was introducing us to Shakespeare's Sonnet 18, "Shall I compare thee to a summer's day?" And like, he admired Shakespeare. He always was talking about Shakespeare 24 hours. And before this sonnet, we took a sonnet for Sir Thomas Wyatt, whose soul is to hunt, I think it was called. So he showed us in this sonnet about Thomas Wyatt how he used the meter, this poet, how he used the meter, the iambic pentameter, to emphasize himself by stressing the pronoun I. And I apply the same thing when he was introducing us to Sonnet 18, how Shakespeare unstressed the thee there. And then he stressed it at the end of the poem to indicate to the addressee that with my words, with my poetry, you will always be like strong and you will live forever. And I raised my hand and I answered like this question. And Dr. Refaat was like, wow, wow, excellent. One bonus mark for you. One bonus mark. I still remember this vividly. I still remember how he said it. And I wasn't happy because of the extra mark. I was happy because I could make him feel happy. A thing students told me that it was impossible, like the doctor would praise you. This incident, making Dr. Refaat proud and happy, encouraged me and my friends to always come prepared to the class and try to think creatively and out of the box as he always wanted. I really miss him. I really do. But I don't believe he's dead. Maybe Israel killed Dr. Refaat. But his inspiration is still within me and within all of his students. Dr. Refaat still teaches me a lot of things. He's teaching me how to always be brave, how to always not to be afraid of anything. He is teaching me that words are very powerful, are immortal. Dr. Refaat's voice reached and encouraged millions of people, although he was in Gaza. He's teaching me how to be kind, generous, and most importantly, how to offer help to others, even in these times I need help. To be a giver always, more than a taker. The last thing I would like to say, the last remark, if Israel killed Refaat, by this action, it had created millions of Refaats. Each one of his friends is a Refaat. Each one of his students is a Refaat. And we will honor him by continuing his mission, by defending Palestine and its just case.
Khaled Hissi, thank you so much. That was gorgeous. And Malik, again, thank you so much for reading that poem. Before we go to some more friends and students, Refaat loves stories, and we wanted to show a clip of Refaat giving a TEDx talk in Shujaya, his neighborhood, and talking about how he was taught by his mother and grandmother about the power of storytelling. Let's go to that.
Now, Edward Said warns of this. If we stop caring about stories, if we stop telling our stories, if we stop listening to our parents, we create space, we create vacuum for others to occupy this virtual space in our past, in our heart. Edward Said says, history is made by men and women. And I love the fact that he refers to this, the fact that this is something made by women and men, not leaders, not politicians, not the elite. Because the history, the oral history for us Palestinians belongs to you, to me, to our mom, to our dad, to our grandparents, to your parents and to your grandparents. Because the oral history should always belong to the people, should shape politics, not the other way around. History is made by men and women, just as it can also be unmade and unwritten in case we just leave it and keep silent. And this also takes me to an amazing story of a native Canadian. When the colonizers took over North America and they wanted to divide the land among themselves, one of the eldest approached them. He asked, "What are you doing?" He said, "We own the land. We are dividing the land among ourselves." He said, "If this is your land, tell me your stories. If this is indeed your land, tell me your stories." And of course, the answer is silence, because they had no stories and they don't own the land. And it also takes me to Africa. And I love how talking about oral history and storytelling connects indigenous native people from all over the world. Chinua Achebe teaches us something. This is a lesson for us all. If the lions do not have their own historians, the history of the hunt will always glorify the hunters, will always glorify the occupier, will always glorify the colonizer rather than the colonized, the oppressed, the indigenous, the rightful people of the land. And believe me, people out there are looking forward to our stories. They want our stories. They seek our stories. And this is the very amazing success story of Gaza Writes Back, which is a book. Gaza Writes Back is a book of 23 stories written in English by young Palestinian men and women between the age of 17 and 25. 13 of the 15 writers are females. 13 of the 15 writers are women, are young women. And this again takes me back to the fact that my mom made me. My mom made me the man I am because of her stories. And my grandmother made me love my country, my homeland.
Oof. I encourage everyone who's listening or watching right now to go over to Refaat's YouTube channel and watch that, as well as some of his lectures. I mean, the TED Talk is extraordinary, and I learn something new every time I watch it, which in the last few days has been many times. We are going to go to one more clip from Zainab Bashir from Gaza. She's a translator, storyteller, and a student of Refaat. Let's go to that clip.
Hi everyone, I'm Zainab, and a student of Dr. Refaat Alareer, may he rest in peace. One thing I learned from Dr. Refaat, may he rest in peace, is that we should never stop writing. Our words matter, our voices matter. There is never wrong, right and wrong in writing and in translating. He always made us brave. He made us believe in ourselves, believe in our translations, believe in our writings. He told us to never stop translating and writing, which because it's powerful, we need it. We have to publish it. We have to share it. We have to show the world our voices and our words. That made us brave. That made us believe more that our voices matter, made us believe more in our translations, in our words. And he did it, encouraged us, every one of us, whenever we go and ask him to look at our translations and our writings, he would always encourage us to publish them. He would always shows us enthusiasm and gets excited and he gets so proud of us. And one thing I would never forget that happened with him was last semester when we were studying Shakespeare course. We were studying Hamlet play, and he was explaining the last line of Hamlet. When Hamlet dies, he says, "The rest is silence." And Dr. Refaat wrote that on the board, and he wrote, "Tell my story," because Hamlet told to his friend to tell his story. Sorry. So Dr. Refaat told us that the best thing that someone can get after his death, it's someone who tells his story and raises his voice. And that stuck in my mind. And when I heard the news of his assassination, I remembered that thing he said. And I said that we should all promise ourselves to amplify his voice and to tell his story, and the rest must not be silenced. The rest should not be silenced, like Hamlet said. May he rest in power. We will all be his voice. And I hope we never fail him.
That's Zainab Bashir from Gaza. We'll also play a clip from Yunus Al-Halaq, a former student of Refaat and also a writer in Gaza. Let's go to that.
Hello, this is Yunus Al-Halaq from Gaza Strip, and I'm also one of the students of the English department at the Islamic University of Gaza. Dr. Refaat Alareer taught us some courses, and Dr. Refaat, when he was teaching us, he wasn't only teaching us the course and he leave the class. No, but Dr. Refaat was like a friend. He was pushing us to do something creative, to do something like to speak, to do, to write back, and to get your voice out. This is what he wanted us to do always, okay? So this is why we believe as his students that he was the best doctor, the perfect doctor that we could ever have. So all of his words, all of his advices, inscribed in our hearts before our minds, okay? The last time I contacted with him, he was pushing me to write in the war. And this is why I published my story, my article on the electronic intifada. And he was always pushing us, that he was always telling us that you have something to do. You have something to write. You have something to speak about. Because you live in Gaza, and Gaza has a lot of stories that are hidden, okay? And the world abroad wants to know such stories, all right? Actually, we love Dr. Refaat Alareer. We loved him so much because he was like dealing with our problems, okay? He was like a friend. So that's why we cried when we saw the video that he was crying in the last video he picked in his sister's house. So may Allah bless his soul.
That's Yunus Al-Halaq, a student of Refaat's, and both Yunus and Zainab, the video before, you could hear the Israeli warplane in the background, and then if you listened really closely, you could also hear the drones in the background of Eunice's video. Unbearable. And we're going to we have a voice message from Khalil Abu Shamala, and then we'll bring some of our guests back on. Let's go to that.
I was choked when I saw that Refaat has been killed by the Israel bombing last week. Refaat was one of the most distinguished teachers at the English department at the Islamic University. And he was one of the most prominent academics in Gaza who was involved in the political issues and the daily life of his society. Refaat was the founder of We Are Not Numbers, which is very meaningful, which conveys a message to the world everywhere that Palestinians in Gaza are not numbers in statistics. They represent stories, ambitions, and dreams, and they should live like the other people all over the world. I believe that we lost Refaat, and we lost one of the very distinguished, respectful, and prominent figure in Gaza.
That's a voice message from Khalil Abu Shamala. Khalil is a veteran human rights activist and a contributor to the Electronic Intifada. We really appreciate him and the work that he does. Khaled, I wanted to bring you back on. You have two messages that you wanted to bring from two of Refaat's students.
Yes. Khaled Al-Qarshalli is one of Dr. Refaat's students. He is saying he couldn't record any video or come to this live session because he doesn't have an internet connection. He barely sent the message, and until now I can't communicate him. He's saying, I took with Dr. Refaat two courses, poetry and Shakespeare, but that is not all what I have learned from him. Dr. Refaat was more than a teacher for me. Despite the great knowledge that I took from him, he taught me that my language and words can be used in many other ways. I was never an early bird at university. I have never attended any lecture of any course that was scheduled at 8 morning. Yes, he's right, I know that. But after attending one lecture for Dr. Refaat, I made sure to not miss any lecture of his, although it was also at 8 morning. I would even make sure to come to the lectures very early, to sit close to him and to hear him clearly. He taught my friends, Mahmoud and Khalid, creative writing at We Are Not Numbers. I tried to be part of it just to be able to learn from him. But unfortunately, before even giving us any lecture, he was killed by the Israeli occupation. He was my role model in defending the Palestinian cause. I remember when I looked at his Facebook account and saw that he had several interviews with several news agencies. I was impressed that my doctor is not only an educator, that he is also a fighter. He fought for Palestine and wrote many stories and books for Palestine. I have always wanted to be like him, to be a writer, a poet, a journalist, and to defend my case. He was and is my inspiration. Dear Dr. Refaat, you are not dead. You are still alive in the heart of every student you taught. I will never forget you or your influence on me. I promise that I will continue learning, writing and defending Palestine till I see you again, inshallah, in heaven. The second message is from Alia Amadi. She is one of Dr. Refaat's best students. She's 20 years old. She is a senior student, was a senior student. She sent me this message. I have known Dr. Refaat for only 2 years. I was then a super bashful sophomore and super scared for composing or writing simply because I was aware that 18 or 19 years of life isn't that much experience. I was just a beginner. but CASP, which is a Culture for Sustainable and Inclusive Peace, a program held in the IUG, was an aperture to the world I discovered in myself, my passions too. There I have known Dr. Refaat a little bit closely. He was so generous, so passionate, and so phenomenal. The 19th of May 2022 was one of the happiest days in my life. Dr. Refaat told us stories about his younger self, about his old friends. He always treated us like friends. We read from Gaza Writes Back, played pun intended, told jokes. He brought us delicious food and fruits. I was finally feeling home, but I showed him a literary piece I translated. My soul soared to the highest highs. Once he said that I should be proud of myself for it. I owe it all to him. And although our acquaintance lasted for only 2 years, my entire university experience, my entire educational journey was rewarding because of him. He bequeathed a very fine literary legacy for minds to feast, and that shall be my companion till my death. I vowed to pass it on, to be one of the voices to tell his story, to make it a tale that brings hope for generations to come until Israel is no more and beyond. That's generous.
Khaled, thank you so much. And please thank those two students on our behalf for joining us. Yeah, thank you. Yusuf, you also wanted to say a few words.
Yes, so I'm working on an article and I asked Refaat to send me a quote, and he sent me a quote on Sunday. I asked him to describe the amount of destruction he has seen after a humanitarian pause took a place in Gaza, and he was able to walk the streets of Western Gaza City. And he said, "I strolled through the western areas of Gaza City and witnessed a level of destruction reminiscent of World War II. The extent of wanton devastation is beyond words. It feels as though tanks played a deliberate and methodical game of destruction, targeting homes, buildings, businesses, infrastructure, schools, mosques, trees, power lines, and poles. The way Israel is ravaging Gaza suggests repercussions that will shape life for generations to come." These were Refaat's words.
When is that article coming out?
Hopefully this week.
Okay. All right. We'll be sure to disseminate that far and wide. Thank you, Yusuf. John, I know that you know Shujaiya. You've been, you know, able to give us a sense of the powerful and ferocious resistance, especially coming from Shujaiya. Refaat was a son of Shujaiya, as many have said on this program. Can you give us a sense of how Shujaiya also plays a part in the story of Refaat and why it's such a significant place?
Yeah, I'm listening to this incredible program. It's I'm so honored to be a part of it, and I do have a little nagging feeling that Refaat would be saying, "Tell us about the resistance news, about what's happening." So I just want to just say a little bit. Based on Refaat's words, what he said about Shujaiya, which means brave and courageous. And he said, "Shujaiya is adjacent to the eastern edge of Gaza, and this means that there's usually a lot of friction. There's a lot of Israeli incursions and a lot of resistance. And Shujaiya, because of the name, the symbolic name, the iconic name, we grew up with this pride because we are from Shujaiya. When a war starts, Israel shells Shujaiya heavily, and this is what they did in 2014. thousands of shells were dropped on houses in Shajaya and people were trying to hide. And I remember people from outside Palestine saying, why didn't you evacuate? Where should we go? Gaza is tiny. And sometimes I take the time to explain to people what a house means. Where I live, my house in Shajaya actually was my grandparents' house. And my grandfather had four boys. One was killed in prison, and then the land was divided among the three that remained. There is a first floor and a second floor, and then we build another floor. And then my two younger brothers, they got married and they built on top of it, and so on. So when we talk about a house, we talk about 70 people living in this structure. You have all your money, all your papers, all your certificates, all your memories, all your photo albums, even your cradle. And this is the cradle where you were born. It keeps moving from one person to another, and then it's all gone in just one click of a button. Refaat's whole life in Shajaya was defined by resistance. Shajaya was where the first Intifada, before it began, the spark was lit in Shajaya when revolutionaries broke out of prison in 1987 and stayed in Shajaya and fought the Israelis. A few weeks later in Jabalia, the first Intifada would begin, and people all over the world had Palestine on their tongues because of the spark that Shajaya lit. And that's the same in 2014, the 2014 war. Shajaya was famous for its resistance, its fierce resistance in that war as well. And in one of Refaat's last tweets, he wrote, I wish I were a freedom fighter, so I would die fighting back against these genocidal maniacs invading my neighborhood. I just wanted to say to Refaat that you were and you are.
Thank you, John.
Nora, may I just add to that beautiful reading from John that, of course, we all know how proud Refaat was of Shajaya and being from Shajaya. And I have to tell you that he called Chicago the Shajaya of America. That was the highest praise he could give us. And I don't know if some of our friends are going to be offended by this, but he thought New York was the Hayazaytun of America.
Is there a Jabalia in the United States?
Well, he explained to me, of course, I'd only had the pleasure of visiting Gaza once, but he explained to me the fierce rivalry between Shajaya and Hayazaytun. And so, well, what can I say? Shajaya is the Chicago of America. There's nothing left to say about that.
Love that. I think we should play some of the clips that our wonderful Tamara has put together of some of the highlights of the many times. We had him on four times during this live stream: day 3, day 7, day 20, and day 55, which was just over a week ago. Tamara, let's go to that clip.
Refaat, I just wanted to say, I think one of the hardest things to come to grips with is that the people who always scream the loudest about the Holocaust and say never again, never again, and we have to learn the lessons of history, particularly American and European leaders, are the ones who are most actively supporting this Holocaust in Gaza, a genocide in Gaza. They're sending airplanes full of bombs to drop on Palestinian babies. And this is the thing that has for me broken broken any sense, any belief I have in all the supposed principles we were taught to revere: human rights, international law, democracy. The people who come to lecture us about human rights and democracy and international law are the ones who are doing this to you, to your family, to 2.3 million people in Gaza. They're the ones who are doing this, the ones who build museums to the Holocaust and say, we need to take Palestinians and Arabs to these Holocaust museums to educate these savages and barbarians, jungle people, as Josep Borrell, the EU foreign policy chief, called them. They're the ones. The White House spokesperson, Karine Jean-Pierre, said that calls for a ceasefire for Gaza are repugnant. What kind of world do we live in where calling for a ceasefire is repugnant? These people worship war. They worship death. I'm 51 years old, and I wake up every day as angry and as enraged and as outraged as I have been my whole life at what they're doing to us. But you know, Refaat, they want us to be nice victims. Yeah. They want us to be polite. They don't like it when we're angry. I get messages saying, oh, you know, you should present yourselves better. You won't win support if you're angry. What support did we win for all these years? All these years of advocacy, of meetings, of lectures, of speeches, of meeting with politicians. Not one European politician objected to cutting food and water and electricity from children. Not one. I'm saying not one leader. Yes, there were a few politicians, a few members of parliament here or there, but not one leader. Not one Arab country. Not one, let's let aside the Europeans, not one Arab country of those regimes run by traitors withdrew their ambassadors from Israel or closed their embassies with Israel. What is this? What is this hell we're living in? People come to us for analysis. I don't know how to analyze this. I don't know what to say to people. But we are, our hearts are in pain, our hearts are broken when we see this world that allows the scenery that we're seeing in Gaza today. Massacre after massacre after massacre of whole families, of 583 children as of this morning. By the time we finish this live stream, the number will have gone up. And people digging in rubble in their bare hands. And this is a world that lectures us about human rights and democracy. I don't know what to say to you, Refaat. I don't know, as you have said, as Khalil said, he doesn't know how to face his children. I don't know how to face you and to face people in Gaza. And I don't know how to say to you that I'm sorry we failed.
Thank you, Ali. I think we didn't fail. We did not. And that's when it comes to, all comes to end. No, we didn't. We didn't submit to their barbarity. We didn't submit to their brutality. And even when Gaza, this attack came when Gaza was in its weakest time possible. Look at what they did to the most invincible army in the area, the fourth strongest army in the world. The humiliation. The humiliation. But it's not only about that. This is not where we get our pride. We get our pride from staying principled at a time when everybody is not. I saw a friend, you know, trashing somebody, saying, like, he was posting some anti-Semitic stuff on Twitter, replying, you know, with anti-Semitic things. And he was like, don't do this. We're not them. And I was very proud. It is at this time that people can be their mettle can be tested, who they are, their character. Those people failed miserably, we didn't. They failed because when it came to the Ukrainians, blonde hair, blue eyes, everybody was sending money. Everybody was posting, even the Israelis were posting pictures, how to make cocktail Molotovs, how little children are carrying guns and fighting the Russian barbarians. Politicians sending money, billions of dollars, competing to send billions of dollars to Ukraine. But when it came to people with darker skin, they failed, and they failed miserably. And I don't want to say I don't know how they sleep, because they don't have a conscience. There is this anti-Arab, anti-Palestinian, anti-Muslim sentiment that is deeply rooted and normalized in the media, in among politicians. It's always been there, but it has just been exposed. And I think there has to be this day, this week has to be a time of, you know, reconsideration. Muslims, Arabs, pro-Palestinians, free people around the world. There has to be something that comes out of this, something stronger than before, more powerful, to learn the lesson that those people are in, like, they are unreliable. They cannot, because some of those people, even Bernie Sanders, and I don't want to name names, because, but they were horrible. I don't want
name
to
name the names. Now is the time.
People, exactly, people in the Congress, and everybody saw this. Israel was heading towards a genocide, and you post 10 tweets explaining why what happened from the Palestinians is wrong, for God's sakes.
That was from day 7, 2 months ago. Yeah, it's surreal how he reassured us in those moments of just deep brokenness. I want to show also the last clip just from a week and a half ago from day 55, and then we'll come back to his students. So let's go to that. Well, I don't have the words to express how happy and relieved we are right now to have our good friend Refaat Alareer with us live from the Gaza Strip, looking handsome and healthy. The smile is something that we've been waiting weeks and weeks and weeks to see again. So Refaat, our good friend and our pretty much de facto editor in the Gaza Strip, thank you so much for being with us today.
Alhamdulillah, as-salam to you and your family. And I don't know if Roger Waters is watching today, but I don't want him to be offended by this, but having you on, this is bigger than Roger Waters.
I'll think of a career shift. Maybe I sing something, but you need to, you know, like clearly close your ears.
We'll take it. Refaat, where do we even start? How are you? How are your kids? How are your how's your wife? How's your family right now?
We are fine, struggling like everybody else in Gaza, especially in the Gaza city and the north, with barely any food, water sources, everything running out. Even the aid that made its way into Gaza is not enough for my extended family, perhaps, to eat in a week. And most of it, I took a footage of some of the trucks, by the way. They're not trucks, they're probably half trucks or a quarter of a truck, and mostly water bottles. Probably every 10, what we need is electricity, fuel, cooking gas, and a flour. These are the four priorities.
Yeah,
and we barely had any of these. And many people will not be getting any of this, because there are too many people. The Gaza municipality estimates that there are about 800,000 Palestinians in Gaza City, and in the north, in Jabalia, Beit Lahia, and Beit Hanun. That's too many people with too few resources. Or family-wise, I haven't seen my kids since the truce started. They moved to another place, and I'm spending most of their time running to places with internet connection, so I can be online. But they are good. Yesterday, we made it to our place where we live in Tel Hawa, and I posted a video. It's complete and utter destruction. I'm not sure how this is going to end, but with what we have now, it's complete and utter destruction. Again, I keep citing the World War II as a reference. The destruction we see in pictures is happening right in front of our eyes.
And that was November 30th, and we couldn't reconnect because the electricity had gone out. And that was just a few days before he was assassinated. We have one more short clip, something that I think just, you know, I was talking about this with John yesterday too. Like I'm so honored to have been a part of these live streams with Refaat and with all of our guests, and especially the first one that we did on day three of the bombing, when Refaat was talking about the toughest thing that he had in his possession was an Expo marker, and to be a part of that, you know, that's now that image and that symbolism has made its way all over the world. People are bringing packages of Expo markers to vigils I've seen, and there's artwork made of him now holding an Expo marker. And so we wanted to just play a little bit from that day three of our live stream, and just to be honored to have known him and to be known by him. And then we'll come back for our students.
We know that it's very bleak, it's very dark. There's no way out. If there's no water, there is no way out of Gaza. What should we do? Like drown? Like commit mass suicide? Is this what Israel wants? And we're not going to do that. And I was telling some friend the other day that I'm an academic. Probably the toughest thing I have at home is an Expo marker. But if the Israelis invade, if they barge at us, charge at us, open door to door to massacre us, I'm going to use that marker, throw it at the Israeli soldiers, even if that is the last thing that I would be able to do. And this is the feeling of everybody. We are helpless. We have nothing to lose.
Ahmed, I know that you wanted to say something about Shajaya yourself. Go ahead.
Before that, I just remembered someone. I didn't want to mention his name, just because Refaat so many times asked me not to mention his, not to harass him. He tweeted that Refaat became sour, and that he was angry because of all the trauma he's been subjected to. And I don't know what's less false and less dishonest than this comment. If you had the privilege to be taught by Dr. Refaat, you'd have understood. But even if you weren't a student of his, just listening to all of these interviews and lectures on his YouTube channel, which I urge everyone to follow and like watch his lectures, and if you read the poem that Malak recited earlier, you'd realize that he wasn't sour. He told us that we have every right to be angry personally, because everything here is also personal. We all lost so many people and so many things, but he wasn't just angry. He wasn't just sour. That's very dishonest. And we always had the hope and also the morality, the ethics of Refaat. He always scolded me personally and many of us for saying the wrong things, even when we had the right, even when we were angry. He always taught us to be smart, to be vocal, to be unapologetic, but always true and always for the good reasons and for the righteous reasons. And that's what we always learned and will continue learning from him. About Shija'iyya, I also come from Shija'iyya, but he always bullied me for being born in a Rimal, not in Shija'iyya. And he was always angry at people for not mentioning Shija'iyya. The last message I received from him Wednesday morning was him telling me that he feels helpless because of what's happening in Shija'iyya, and that he's proud of our fighters, of our neighbors who are fighting the tanks in Shija'iyya, but he feels so helpless because of all the destruction and everything that's happening, and because of how nobody talks about Shija'iyya and how it's not even mentioned, and even when it's mentioned, it's East Gaza, not Shija'iyya. Because he's a proud son of Shija'iyya, and one of his wishes is to keep Shija'iyya in people's minds, and we have every right to be proud, like he was in, like he is in our fighters who fight in Shija'iyya, but also we need to remember Shija'iyya and talk about Shija'iyya and all the destruction that's been happening in Shija'iyya and all the other neighborhoods of Gaza. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Ahmed, I hope that you will write about Shija'iyya. I hope that you will write about Shija'iyya. I just want to share one thing, because those watching those clips again, I know it's emotional for everyone. There was one show we had. This was during one of the blackouts, the communications blackouts in Gaza, when we couldn't reach Refaat. We'd wanted to have him on. We wanted to have him as many times as we could, but we couldn't reach him. And this was day 45 of the war, of the genocide. And we had Yusuf on, and we wanted to have Yusuf and Refaat together, but we couldn't. So we instead we had a discussion about Refaat. We talked about his work and his impact. We talked about how important Refaat was for so many reasons, but especially to us at the Electronic Intifada, because I would say most of the writers who write for us from Gaza today and about Gaza today were trained by Refaat and nurtured and encouraged by Refaat. And so the Electronic Intifada as a publication would not be what it is without Refaat's effort. And so I wanted people to know who he was. He'd already been on the live stream, but Refaat is not somebody who brags. He's not somebody who says, I did this and I did that. He's a very humble person. And so it was important for us to acknowledge his presence in that show. And afterwards, some days afterwards, he sent me a message. He said, I downloaded the episode with Ahmed. We had Ahmed Mas'ud as well from London. But Rifat wrote, I downloaded the episode with Ahmed and Yusuf and John on YouTube, watched it last night at home. Really, thanks for the nice words. They mean the world to me, especially coming from an arch enemy like Yusuf. And so I, those of you who know, those of you, and then when he got cut off on that final appearance, when we couldn't reconnect with him, and sadly that was the last time, he sent me a message. He said that he was mad that he got cut off because he said, I wanted to rebut all of Yusuf's lies. So those of you who know Rifat and Yusuf will know that that was an act that Rifat carried on for years, that Yusuf was his enemy. But from the times I spent with you both, I know, Yusuf, how much Rifat loved you dearly. And that was his way of expressing it.
Yes, and you know, the thing that makes me happy is that Rifat was able to watch what I said about him when he was still physically with us. And I think it's important that, and I'm sure that there are also many other people who conveyed to Rifat how much they appreciated him and they loved his work and dedication to us as students, but also to Palestine. This is, you know, the least we can do and tell Rifat. And I will, you know, cherish this title in the most ironic way, Rifat's arch enemy, as he called me and accused me of trying to out Rifat him or outsmart him. But, you know, Rifat is many things to me, but, you know, the most important thing is that I am his student.
Yeah. Malik and Noor, did you want to have some time for any final thoughts on Rifat and what he meant to you?
Yeah, sure. I always remember him with one tiny thing he used to do, especially with me, because I hate it when people mispronounce my name. I hate it when people say Malak, and he would always, always call me Malak. And then when I started calling him Dr. Rafat instead of Rifat, he started calling me Saadi, and I was like, I beg you, go back to Malak. I'm happy with Malak. Please go back to Malak. My mom, I managed to talk to my mom today after 3 days of trying. And I was so blessed to talk to her. And the first thing, I swear, the first thing she said, Malak Habibti, I hope you're doing good, because I only knew about Dr. Rifat yesterday and I couldn't stop thinking about you. I know how he meant to you, how much he meant to you. And it just breaks my heart, because I wanted to make sure my mom's doing okay, and she turned out to be so worried about me because we lost someone so dear. I don't know what to say. It's just how life is. May his soul rest in power.
Thank you. Noor and Khaled. Khaled, let's start with you.
Just remembered something funny that happened with us while we were taking the poetry course with Dr. Defan. We were about to finish Shakespeare, the period of Shakespeare. We were moving to the other period. So the students were comparing, like, maybe Shakespeare is not the better poet. And like, he was respecting Shakespeare and loving Shakespeare. So he said, like, everyone has like his thought. But the most one thing you have to know about Dr. Refaat is that he loved watching football, and he always who loved Barcelona. I don't know how to say it in English. He loved Messi very much. Like he thought like Messi is the ideal football player. He was always fighting for him. Maybe Mr. Ahmed Nihad knows that. So some students stood up and said, like, yeah, there are people that saying that there are no God. So Dr. Refaat looked at him and said, yeah, there are some people who are saying Ronaldo is better than Messi. And like we all started laughing because like we knew he always loved football, loved Messi.
We're going to play one final clip, but before we do, Asa, I know that we've just been flooded with so much love for all of our guests here today, for the just immense amount of love for Refaat and how that love was received by him. Let's go to a few of the comments that we've received.
Yeah, well, it would be absolutely impossible to read out all of the support that we've had on the live stream today. I wanted to read out a couple of comments from our friend Roger Waters. Said, thank you all for your stories. He was listening today. We also had Katie Halper as well dropping into the live chat saying it's incredible how Refaat's sense of humor still brings laughter and smiles during this sad time. Our friend Jennifer Bing as well said that, agreeing with Yusuf, saying Refaat will live on in our hearts and will motivate our activism and stories until Palestine is free. Katie White's in Hastings in the UK, and she, I know Katie, she's an activist in Palestine Solidarity Campaign, giving support to Shaima early on in the stream, saying thank you for sharing your memories. He would be so proud. And we were absolutely inundated with comments today in support of Dr. Refaat. It was a very emotional stream. People are also sending in emojis of the pen and the kite. And we also had a lot of people saying they were learning about Dr. Refaat for the first time now. And that learning about him and his stories and the work that he inspired would motivate them further. So thank you everybody who wrote in.
And indeed.
Can I just add, we're so grateful to all of Refaat's friends and students who shared their stories and their reflections today. And we're conscious that you are but as immense and awesome as you are, you're just a small group of those who Refaat trained and taught and influenced for the better. And so we send our love to all of Refaat's students and all of his friends who couldn't join us today or who we couldn't reach, especially those in Gaza. And just to say that if we look at the front page of the Electronic Intifada on any given day, there are going to be stories on the front page from Refaat students, and that's going to continue. Refaat was, people have called him the storyteller of Gaza. I've seen him also called the man who taught Gaza to speak English. There are many great titles people are giving Refaat. We really owe him for he helped open Gaza to me. I feel like I have so many friends in Gaza and so many friends from Gaza because of Refaat. And so I just want to say to all of his students, past, present, and future, because we will continue to learn from Refaat, thank you, and please do keep writing. We feel like we are now part of a bigger family, and Refaat connects us all. And we at the Electronic Intifada are so grateful for you, and we will continue to be honored to be your platform.
Absolutely. It is a great and deep honor. Thank you, Ali. Let's close out by this last clip that we have prepared of Refaat giving a lecture.
Now, how many of you, like, have you ever been to Jerusalem? Raise your hand if you've ever been to Jerusalem. Like, we have 60 students here. We have one, two, probably three. That's very few of you. I've never been to Jerusalem. We're Palestinians. We're living in Gaza. We can't go to Jerusalem because of the Israeli occupation. But we love Jerusalem, right?
Yes.
We love Jerusalem because of what it means to us. We've never been there. But believe me, when you go there, you will feel that you've been there hundreds of times because you read about Jerusalem in literature, in story. It doesn't mean that khalas, we should take Jerusalem, that Jerusalem in the poem or in the story and that's it. No. But in literature, Jerusalem is back to us, comes back to us. So it's true that there is suffering, there is pain, there's occupation, and that's why Tamim al-Barghouti, as a Palestinian poet, as a young Palestinian poet, I think is doing a great service to the Palestinian cause and the Palestinian struggle. When you read Tamim or you listen to him reciting his poem, Fil-Quds, or other poems, he brings you a lot, he takes you to Jerusalem. You live Jerusalem. He takes you back to it. You liberate it for just a little bit of time. And if there is hope, if you can imagine a free Palestine, free Jerusalem, probably you will work towards that. And the same thing applies to occupied Palestine. We've never been to other parts of Palestine because of the Israeli occupation, but we've been told so many times by our parents and grandparents, especially our mothers. They've been telling us stories about Palestine, Yamli Blad, in the past, the good old days, how Palestine was, you know, all nice and beautiful, unoccupied, unraped. And therefore, I say, in this case, how our homeland turns into a story. In reality, we can't have it. We don't have it. But it can turn into poems, into poetry, into literature, into stories. So our homeland turns into a story. We love our homeland because of the story. We love our homeland because of the story. And we love the story because it's about our homeland. And this connection is significant. Israel wants to sever this relationship, for example, between Palestinians and land, Palestinian and Jerusalem and other places and cities. And literature attaches us back, connects us strongly to Palestine. So in my imagination, in my thinking, actually, this is a very significant thing that literature contributes to, creating realities, making the impossible sound possible.
We love you, Refaat. Just want to say thank you again to all of our friends, colleagues, contributors, Yusuf, Ahmed, Noor, Malik, Khaled, and everyone who is here beforehand. Thank you all so much. Again, I just wanted to promote all of the features that we have on the Electronic Intifada right now. As Ali said, many of them, if not all of them right now on the features page, are from people that Refaat has mentored and taught. And it's really powerful. And so we encourage you all to go to electronicintifada.net, sign up, get the updates. You can get the emails in your inbox. And also, go to our YouTube page, like and subscribe and do all of that. You can sign up to get alerts for the next live stream. And speaking of which, we are going to have another live stream on Thursday. So please stay tuned for that. On behalf of me and Ali and John and Asa, we want to thank Tamara and Nassar behind the scenes, who has just been working so beautifully to put all of this together, all of these media clips and being in touch with all of our contributors. Thank you, Tamara. You're extraordinary. And thank you, everyone, so much.